we're here, but I like being in church on Saturday night. Man, I like being in church on Saturday night because I tell folks, I said, I know what some of you used to do on Saturday night. Not exactly what you did, but I can guess, okay? I know what I used to do on Saturday night. And I like to think, you know, there's a time when if somebody would have told me that I was going to be in church on Saturday night, you wouldn't even want to record what I said. So it is just good to be saved. It really is. Well, let me get this message, and thank you for coming. I want you to open your Bibles. I believe it's Joshua chapter 4. Yeah, I'm not preaching out of that. I'm going to see if it's in your version. Joshua chapter 4. Joshua chapter 4, a question is is asked in this chapter. This is when the children of Israel were about to cross the Jordan River. They'd already crossed the Red Sea, about to cross the Jordan River. You know that the crossing of the Jordan River was kind of like a Red Sea crossing light. God stopped the whole Red Sea, parted it. They crossed on dry ground. In the case of the Jordan River, we were over in Israel a couple of years ago. Jordan River is about as wide as this sanctuary. You could throw a rock across it. But still, it was no small thing that God parted the, you know, he stopped the flow of the Jordan and they crossed on dry ground. And he said this, he said, when you get there, look at verse 5. Joshua said unto them, pass over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of Jordan, and take you up every man of you a stone upon his shoulder, according unto the number of the tribes of the children of Israel. So here's what he's saying. He's saying, you guys are going to cross this river. You're going to start over here. You know, he stopped it up. You're going to start here. You're going to end up over there. You're going to be in the promised land when you get to this side, correct? He said, when you get here, when you're about halfway across, I want you to pick up a stone. Now, this is not a small stone. Put it on your shoulder, okay? I mean, it's not like a little, it's like something like a concrete block. he said, put that stone up on your shoulder. And look at verse 6. That this may be a sign among you that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean ye by these stones? And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. What mean ye by these stones? Let's bow our heads. Let's talk to the Lord. Father, I've said it before, and I'm right. I'm right. I know I'm right when I say we have no problem with you because there is nothing wrong with you. And I know I'm right when I say we have no problem with the Bible because there's nothing wrong with the Bible. But Lord God, anything that man is in, anything that I am in, is automatically flawed and in danger. Which means, God, that the danger of this service is that you will not be here and leave it up to me. And these poor folks drove way too far to hear from me. Now, I don't think they want to hear from me, God. These folks do not want, they didn't come here to hear from me. They want something from you. They want something from your book. And if they don't get it tonight, it will be my fault. So, Lord, please, for their sake, the time they put in, the drive, whatever, God, for their sake, would you please get Sam Gipp out of your way, out of their way. Please speak to their hearts. God, pick something in this message and deal with each heart. In some way, that when this meeting is over, when this message is over, every one of them may be taking a step or two or three farther down the road you want them to go. And that would be a good thing. It'd be worth coming to church for. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now, I'm not into stone cairns. You know, we go out west a lot and we're climbing up, national parks and these idiots, you know, they have to put all these pile rocks up, you know. We were in Death Valley. Death Valley's really neat. I know it sounds awful, but it's one of our favorite places. One of our favorite places. And in Death Valley, there's a lot of places where the water has washed through. And I mean washes that are every bit deeper than this is, than this room is tall. And then there's one place, you know, you're coming in there and it's maybe this wide and then it opens up into a great big place. And you see all these stone cairns. Now, isn't it funny the people that think that everything should be natural put up stone cairns? You say, what do you do? Well, I don't go to that church. I knock them down. You say you don't. Oh, yeah, it feels so good. It really does. Just know I messed up somebody's religious service. This blesses my heart. All right. And so I'm not into that, but that is kind of what happened here. And I'm going to talk to you tonight about what mean ye by these stones. We're going to look at about, five places in Scripture. Keep your place here. We're going to leave Joshua 4, but we're going to come back to Joshua 4, so keep a place here. And we're going to look at five outstanding stones in this book and just ask the question, what mean ye by these stones? Look at Exodus chapter 24. Exodus chapter 24. And it says this, let's pick it up about verse 1. He said, and he said unto Moses, come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord hath said will we do. Hey, guys, that's an easy thing to say. It takes a whole lifetime to fulfill that statement. Verse 4, and Moses wrote all these words of the Lord and rose up early in the morning and builded an altar under the hill and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, let me tell you, I was doing some study some years ago. There was a guy named, I think it was Ron Wyatt. He is now with the Lord. I can't remember exactly what he was. He was actually not a professional archaeologist, but he did stuff in archaeology. And I wouldn't say that everything that he claims to have discovered was probably accurate. He says he thinks he found the Ark underground in Turkey. They had this underground, ground radar, whatever that is, where they can look down into the ground, and they found a boat shape. And so they said, see, the ark's here. Well, now look, guys, I mean, if you're standing on the ground and you say the boat's under here, how do you prove it? Dig a hole. Nobody ever dug the hole. So I'm not too sure about that. But one of the things he says, if you know this, this is not the peace symbol, this is the Red Sea. And this is the Sinai Peninsula right down in here between these two fingers. And standard teaching is that when the children of Israel came out of here, when they kind of came out of Egypt, they crossed the Red Sea up here. And Ron Wyatt says, no, they did not. He said, they crossed the Red Sea down here. And what he found right here, right at this point, two things he found. First off, from one side of the Red Sea to the other, there's a raised area like a land bridge. It's like where the water is shallower all the way across. So that the water went down, it would be the first thing to be open. And he went diving in there, and they found broken chariot wheels and swords and shields, etc. He said on one side were two pillars that said, this is the place where the children of Israel crossed. And when he got to Saudi Arabia on the other side, there was two other pillars that said, this is the place where children of Israel crossed. And he went to the Saudi Arabian government and said, hey, guys, you've got a great tourist attraction here. And they said, yes, we do. And they went and tore the pillars down. Here's what he says. If this is the Sinai Peninsula, right here is supposed to be Mount Sinai. If your map in your Bible is accurate, or honest, I should say, it'll have this. It'll say Mount Sinai and then have in parentheses a question mark. Because nobody knows if this is Mount Sinai. And if you read your Bible, you know this can't possibly be Mount Sinai because this is still technically part of Egypt. To this day, that Sinai Peninsula is part of Egypt. They weren't out of Egypt until they got here. And this is Saudi Arabia. And if you read Galatians chapter 1, the Bible says Mount Sinai, which is in Arabia. That's kind of one of those things you really have to ponder and find the deeper truth. And he says that over here in Arabia, he found what he believes is Mount Sinai. Now, one of the things he mentions is, and I've heard this, I've talked to guys, he must have been nuts. Some guy, he went on one of these Holy Land trips and he went to Mount Sinai. And he said, they get up at like 2 o'clock in the morning to climb this Egyptian Mount Sinai because they wanted to see the sunrise from Mount Sinai. I don't even want to see the sunrise. Okay? I have seen so many sunrises. I see sunrises when I have to get up early to catch a plane. I get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to catch a plane and I see a sunrise and it's all involuntary. Or I get up early and we hook up and start driving and I watch a sunrise. Or I just lay in bed unable to sleep and I just watch the room grow brighter. There's nothing, I cherish none of that. Okay? These people go, ooh, I like to see a sunrise. You people, I like sunrise service. That's because you're sick. If I want to see a sun, I don't care if the sun comes up gradually or they flip a switch, all right? If I want to see a sunrise, you know what I do? I see a sunset and think backwards. a few years ago, I think it was 2009, 2010, I was going over to London to do some study in the British Library on some on a book I was working on. And we got to England right at sunrise, and we're 5,000 feet above the city. The city is still dark, and at the horizon of the earth is a beautiful band of light. One of the most beautiful sunrises I have ever seen in my life. Wasn't voluntary. I'll take it. I would not try to do it again. Okay? So you know, sunrise doesn't do anything for me. And this guy said, but you're going to get to 2 o'clock in the morning and climb a mountain to see one? If you're not on drugs, get on drugs, because that will explain being that stupid. And he said, you can't believe it. He said, man, this is like hand over fist and foot. You know, he's climbing like on a ladder. That's what this Mount Sinai in Sinai in Egypt is like. And one of the things that Ron Wyatt said, because he'd climbed that, he said, how did Moses bring down 2 tablets on that? Yeah. Fact is, word, there are actually 3 tablets and 15 commandments, but he dropped one early coming down. But guys, he said, over here in Arabia, he said he found this mountain, and he said the first thing is that the whole top 40 feet of it is burnt. Remember when Mount Sinai was in the cloud of fire? It's all burnt. He said there's a cave in there, because if you remember in 1 Kings, Elijah had a cave where he hid in Mount Sinai. He said, get this, and he has pictures of this. He said at the base is this altar. That altar that Moses built is still there, and those pillars are still there. Now, maybe the Arabians have knocked them down, but at that time they were there. And so you come by, you know, and you see those pillars. You say, what mean ye by these pillars in the desert? Well, first thing it meant, that is where the children of Israel met God. Man, you remember when you met God? I met God June 14th, 1970. That was when I was a lost Roman Catholic drunkard. Preacher got done as a missionary in the Philippines, got done preaching in the college career class church I was going to. Gave the invitation. I stepped out. I came down here. Here's how this worked. I left that pew on my way to hell. I went back that pew on my way to heaven. I came down to the altar. I got on my knees on my way to hell. I got off my knees on my way to heaven. I got on my knees, according to John chapter 8, verse 44, a son of the devil. I got off my knees, according to John chapter 1, verse 12, a son of God. That is where I met God. You remember when you met God? Man, it's kind of a special thing to meet God. If you haven't met with God, guys, I'm telling you, you're not going to heaven. You ought to remember. Come on. I mean, you ever meet anybody special? I would think meeting God's a little special. And I talk to people, you know, I met this famous person. Well, I'll tell you a famous person I met, God. Not bad concerning he only wrote one book, and he never even had to do a sequel. And he hadn't had anything to it since then. And so, guys, what I'm saying is, do you remember when you met God? You know what that... Those Jews, they had those columns there, those pillars. You know what that was a reminder of? Those stones, remember, this is where we met God. Boy, don't you know that them Jews could look back and think about what it must have been like, remember what it was like when they were down there on that desert floor and they looked up. What would it be like to see a mountain on fire? You know, we came out of school many years ago. I think it was like 73, 1973. And there was an orange glow. This orange glow in the sky. And so we drove over there, and as near as I can tell, a landfill caught fire. Bunch of homeless guys didn't get any furniture that week. But this landfill was on fire, and it was one of the most realistic pictures of hell that I ever saw. I mean, the whole place was just on fire. But you know, can you imagine being down on this desert floor, and you know that the man of God is up there, and up there in that flame? I mean, you would never forget that. You know, some of those kids were like these little children right here. I'll bet all their life they remember what it was like to look up on that mountain. And they remember their parents were never the same after that night. Say, what happened? They met God. Man, I remember when I met God. This is where the first time they heard from God. I remember the first time I heard from God. Now, I'm going to tell you something. It's going to sound so crazy, but that's okay. That's okay, because this is what happened. Now, I've often said in my testimony, you know, as a Roman Catholic, there was no Bible in our home. The reason I say that is because when I was 19 years old, I came about that close to blowing my brains out. I was going to kill myself one night, and I searched our house. Nobody was home. I searched our house for a Bible. I could not find a Bible. So I say there was no Bible, but somewhere years before that, And I don't know how old I was, 9, 10, 11, 12, something like that, 13. There was a Bible. And the way I know is somebody sent my family a chain letter. You remember those things? You get them on the internet now, like electronic chain letters. And chain lightning, I guess. But anyway, and it said, and it had in there the scripture out of Matthew and Mark about if you ascend to this mountain, be cast into the sea. If you have faith like a grain of mustard seed and be cast into the sea, you know what will happen. And I remember reading that in a Bible in our home. Now, again, I don't know where that Bible went to. Maybe it was someplace where I could not find it when I was looking for it a few years ago. Maybe it was in the house, but there was no Bible and I needed one. And I'm sure that thing where I looked in that Bible happened before what I'm about to tell you about. And in my room, my bedroom, there was a wall here at the head of the bed, wall on the left side of the bed. And at the foot of the bed was a window, and that faced the back of the house. And about three blocks away, we had five steel mills. And on summer nights, I'd just switch ends, and I'd open up the bedroom window, and I'd just sit there in that bed, and I'd listen to the sound of steel mills. I like the sound of mills. I know some people say, oh, I like to be out in the country and hear the babbling brook. Oh, man, I like to hear a yard engine. I like to hear a diesel spooling up and yanking a carload of steel. I like to hear some crane dropping some steel up, clang, 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 clang. That's just music to me, man. That was my lullaby. And don't ask me how old I was, but I got talking to God about faith. Now, the only reason I think these are related is because I'd read that scripture. The only scripture I'd ever seen in my Bible in my life was that scripture on faith. That if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you say that mountain, be cast in the sea, and be cast in the sea. But I'm looking out this window, and I'm looking at the sky, and I'm talking to God, lost. And this was the conclusion that I came to on faith. I said, God, if I really had faith in you, and you told me to jump off a cliff, I could do it. I wouldn't have to worry. And you say, well, that sounds kind of crazy. Yeah, it does. And here's the thing. Now, again, I wasn't trying to be Gideon, didn't know who Gideon was. But I said this. I said, God, if I'm right about faith, that you can be trusted. What I was saying was that God could be trusted. Do you understand? And I said, if I am correct, let me see a shooting star. Now you say, well, why would God do that? God owes me nothing. He owes you nothing. And I'm telling you guys, I mean, those words no sooner left my mouth than a shooting star went across the sky. And then I must have a little Jewish blood in me. I must be some relative of Gideon, because as soon as I got my answer, you know what I said? Now I want the fleece to be wet. And so I said, okay, God, if that was really you, let me see another a shooting star so I know the first one wasn't just an accident. And I'm telling you guys, sure as I'm standing here, boom, the second one happened just like that. Now, there nothing dramatic happened in my life after that except that right there. But that is the first time I can tell you I know I heard from God. And that may be, again, starting with that scripture, and then that evening, even though I was lost, I understood faith. And faith was that if God tells you to do something, no matter how absurd it sounds, you can do it. Just do it. You know, if there's anything that stops people from doing the will of God, it is not that they don't know the will of God. They know the will of God. It just don't make any sense to them. Or they go, well, how am I going to do this? Well, if I quit my job, well, how are we going to live? Look, if you're going to worry about it, you're never going to do it. And that faith, you know, really, if you think about jumping off a cliff and trust the Lord to take care of you, that's light work compared to just get on your knees and trust Him to save you. But it's some years later, I got down on my knees and I cast my soul off that cliff into the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I got saved. And then throughout my life since I got saved, those things, that stuff on faith, I'll give you an example. When we went back into evangelism 31 years ago, I knew the Lord had been dealing with me for about a year or two about going back into evangelism. When I left Bible college in 73, 19, I was in evangelism for 5 years, and it was wonderful. My wife and I just about starved to death. You say, why? Well, nobody wanted a 23-year-old that knew everything. You know, if I'd been 25, that would make more sense. But anyway, and so we had 5 years in evangelism, and then I was 4 years as a youth director in a church, 2,000 people. Then I pastored a church of for five years. I got on good behavior. And so for about a year or two, the Lord had been dealing with me about leaving the church. And I knew God wanted me to do one of two things. Go back into evangelism or go to the west of this country and take a church. And I'm telling you the truth, guys. Here's the exact words I prayed. I said, God, I said, I know I got a choice. I know I'm going to be doing one of these two things. I'm going west and taking a church, or I'm going back into evangelism. I said, if I have any input on this, please, not evangelism. I said, because there's little things in life I like to do, like eat and pay bills. That's what I told him. Those are the exact words. So we went west. We took a little tour out west. I went to a preacher I'd never met before in the state of Utah. And I said, I believe the Lord might be dealing with me about coming out and taking a church. Do you know of any? He said, I know of six churches right now need a pastor. And he said, I will call him. Well, I had to leave town. And I said, look, I'm going to go back to New York. I'm going to call you on this Sunday night, September 7th, 1986. I said, I'm going to call you, and you tell me what you found out. And before I dialed this guy on that night, here's what I told Kathy. If this guy has got a church with six drunken Indians, I'm taking it. If he says, I mean, he's got six churches here, guys. And there's got to be one of them open, okay? And if it's six drunken Indians, we're taking it. That's the will of God. We've got to be an open church here. And I called this guy up, and he said, brother, I don't know what happened. But he said, there's not one door open. And I said, that's okay, brother. I said, thank you. And I hung up, and I looked at Kathy, and I said, babe, next Sunday I'm resigning the church. We're going back into evangelism, and if God doesn't take care of us, we're going to starve to death. And the next Sunday, I resigned. But let me tell you what happened. Now, I had been in evangelism, but when I pastored, I did not take meetings. I did not go out and preach. And so I never called anybody, said, we have me in, or nobody ever called me because they'd heard me preach. So here's Tuesday. Tuesday, I'm in my church. I'm at the altar, and I'm weeping like a baby because I'm surrendered to leave. I'm going to resign Sunday. That's not a problem. But I've got to take this church out of my heart. You understand? And so I gave that to the Lord. And here's what I said to the Lord. On my knees at the altar, I'm done praying. And I said, Lord, I said, look, this is not if you do this, I'll do it. I said, this Sunday, I'm resigning. No problem. I'm going to resign because I know you want me to. But I said, for me, if you really want me in evangelism, would you have somebody call today and ask for a meeting? And I went into my office, and half an hour later, a guy that had been one of my students in a Bible college in upstate New York called me, and he said, this July, I'm starting a camp meeting, and I want you to come and preach for it. And I said, hey, Tom, I said, has God ever used you? He goes, I don't know, brother. I said, well, he did today. Yeah. And then Thursday night, I had to have my assistant over because I didn't want my assistant pastor to find out Sunday night when I resigned that I'm resigning. And so I had him and his wife over, and I could not broach the subject. I just couldn't bring it up. And so I said this. I said, Lord, I said, you're going to have to help me on this. I don't know how you can do it, but help me. And about that time, the phone rang, and I went in the kitchen, and it was a guy asking me for a meeting. And I walked back in. He goes, who's on the phone? I said, God. That week, from Sunday to Sunday, that week, five guys called and asked for meetings. You say, what is it? That's that shooting star. I can still remember the first time God spoke to me. The first time I heard from God. Can you remember the first time you heard from God? I mean, it was a special place, guys. I don't know where you were. You may have been desperate. You may have been brokenhearted. You may have been mad. You may have been mad at God. I don't know. But I'm telling you, if you can remember, if you heard from God, you remember first place you heard from God. You know, we came here. We lived just 4 miles, 3 miles from this church in an old farmhouse that if the windows were closed, the curtain still moved. And we couldn't even afford wood for the wood burner. And I burnt my library to stay warm, which wasn't bad. I just got the pictures of the books I already colored the pictures in. But you know, then the Lord took care of that. We have those lessons back there, the valiant for the truth. And here's what happened, guys. I'd come into churches and somebody'd say, we sent our son or daughter to a quote-unquote King James Bible college, and the first thing they heard was King James homosexual, the italics need to be taken out of the Bible needs to be updated, the archaic words need to be changed. And kids who believe the Bible would come back to a church like this one that sent them to college, and they would call their pastor heretic and break fellowship with their family and go someplace else. I heard that so many times. And I said, why should we have to re-evangelize our own children? Let's inoculate them before they go. And it took me 3 years to do the first set of lessons. And I remember I called and I told my wife, I sent it to a printer for an estimate. And he's going to call me in a week, or I got to call him in a week or two. And I said, I told Kathy, I said, brace yourself. I'd already spent $5,000 just on the graphics for him. Now we're gonna print the lessons. And I said, brace yourself, Kathy. I said, I bet it's gonna be $24,000. We didn't have $24,000. I don't know why that figure came. $24,000. Man, I was wrong. By half. I called this guy up and he said, it'll be $48,000. And now here's what I thought at that moment. I didn't think you don't have the money, because I didn't have the money. I thought, for the 3 years I've been writing these, kids have gone to Bible college and lost their faith in their Bible. There's not going to be another year like that. There's not going to be one more year like that. I'm not going to have another one lose it this year, and it's more lose it next year, because these are sitting on a shelf. Wait, and I said, print them. I said, print them just like I was Trump. And I said, I hung that phone up, and I had no idea how I was going to pay for them. I'm telling you something, guys. When those things were done, they were paid for. And as sure as I stand here, I cannot tell you where the money came from. But I know that the second set took 1 year, and 1 year later, it was the same. It was $52,000. I didn't have $52,000, and those were paid for when they were done. You say, where'd that come from? First time I heard from God. I was lost. But I learned something about faith. Guys, first time, can you remember the first time? You know what them stones meant? Those pillars, they said, oh man. Oh, can you see these children? These children now tell, they're grown. You know, I see Amos. And Amos was young when I first came here. And Ben was young when I came here. And everybody was young when I came here. Anyway, and now, you know, now here Ben and Amos, they've got these little children. And can you see these children someday talking to their kids? They'll be 30 and 40, and they'll be telling about, let me tell you, the first time I heard from God. Well, those little children sitting at the foot of that mountain, just staring up at that fire. Daddy, is Moses coming back? Yeah, son, he's coming back. I don't know, is he up in that fire? He's probably right up in that fire. We should have given him some marshmallows. But when that little kid grew up, man, if any of him and his kids happened down that way, and that little boy said, hey, Dad, what's in pillars? Oh, son, you know what you're looking at? You're looking at the first place I was when I was your age, first time I ever heard from God. Man, people, it's precious, first time you hear from God. Guys, this is where they heard from God. This is where they met God. This is where they chose God. Look at verse 3. All the words which the Lord hath said will we do. I'll bet you there are people sitting here right now. You may not have used those exact same words, but you prayed that same prayer. Somewhere along the line, you were laying in your bed. You're looking at the stars. You're maybe at the altar. You might have been driving to or from work, and God got in that car with you. And somewhere along the line, your eyes filled with tears, and you said, God, as long as I got strength in my body, I'm going to serve you. You said that same thing. Your heart was in the same place. You were standing at the foot of Mount Sinai. You were looking up at the same God and the same fire. You were making the same covenant. You got the same pillar, guys. What mean you by these stones? That pillar in the desert was where they met God and heard from God and chose God. Look at chapter 28. The book of Exodus, chapter 28. And get 28 in one hand and 39 in the other. Exodus chapter 28, I'll begin to read at verse 15. And thou shalt make the breastplate. Now, this is where they're getting from 25 to 35. Exodus chapter 25 to 35. Those 10 chapters are where the Lord gives them the directions and instructions for the tabernacle and all of the tabernacle furniture and the clothes that the priests are going to wear. Just check it out. Those 10 chapters, that's what they do, or 11. And so he's coming down to the breastplate that the high priest had said, thou shalt make the breastplate of judgment with cunning work. After the work of the ephod, thou shalt make it of gold, of blue, and of purple, of scarlet, and of fine twined linen shalt thou make it. You know one of the things I like about my God? You know, you don't just have to like God. You know, most people like God just because they got something from him. But even if I didn't get anything from him, he likes color. Man, I appreciate God. God likes color. Look at the flowers. Isn't that amazing? Look at the birds. Look at the animals. Look at the fish. In Tucson, Arizona, if you ever get out there, go to the Desert Museum. And in the Desert Museum, they got this room, and it might be, maybe from that pillar out to about here. It's all dark with showcases like a jewelry store, except all that's in all of those cases are rocks. Just rocks, little stones, some of them the size of a golf ball, some of them a little bigger. And they are unimaginable colors. There are bright greens. There are dark green like velvet. There's pure white. There's absolutely ebony black. There's bright red. There's turquoise. There's orange. There's a blue like the sky. There's blue like velvet. I mean, I am looking at all these colored rocks. Now, this is my theory. You know what my theory is? My theory is that before the flood, I'll bet them rocks were on top. I'll bet even the top of the ground is beautiful. And so you got to like it. God likes colors. Foursquare, verse 16, foursquare shall it be, being doubled. A span shall be the length thereof, and a span shall be the breadth thereof. And thou shalt set it in settings of stones. Even four rows of stones. The first row shall be a sardis, and a topaz, and a carbuncle. This shall be the first row. And the second row shall be an emerald, a sapphire, and a diamond. The third row, a ligure, an agate, and an amethyst. And the fourth row, a beryl, and an onyx, and a jasper. They shall be set in gold in their enclosing. The stone shall be with the names of the children of Israel, 12 according to their names, like the engravings of a signet. Every one with his name shall they be according to the 12 tribes. So you have this breastplate, and you got three rows of four stones, all diverse stones, but all color, correct? Because even the diamond guys, come on. I mean, if you got all those other colors, that pure diamond shows up. And so you got those colored stones. And every one of those stones represents one of the tribes of Israel. Do you know what a diamond is? That is a piece of coal that has seen some serious pressure. That is all there is. You know, they go, oh, that's made over millions of years. Well, that could be true, except they made them in laboratories. They can take a piece of coal and literally pressurize it, like pressure cook it, and it comes out a diamond. They can. It just takes. They just put it in the machine and leave it in there for like 18 million years, and. But here are these stones. But take a look at this. Look at chapter 39, and look where this ephod was. Verse 14. And the stones were according to the names of the children of Israel, 12 according to their names, like the engravings of a signet, every one with his name according to the 12, that 12 tribes. Do you know where this thing ended up? Now, basically, a stone's a piece of dirt. Good-looking piece of dirt, but a piece of dirt. And so you got a piece of dirt that ended up over the heart of the high priest who goes into the Holy of Holies where God is. You ever hear of rags to riches? How about dirt to Holy of Holies? That'd be a pretty good story, isn't it? You say, well, who's it about? Isn't it about you? Ain't I talking to a bunch of walking, talking pieces of dirt? Some stacked higher, some stacked wider, but you're just so much dirt, aren't you? And really, you know, look, ladies, mothers, I love mothers. I had one. Let me tell you the two problems with mothers. There's two problems with mothers. Number one, no mother should ever be allowed to have a wet washcloth in her hand. Because you can have the most delicate, sweet, loving, kind, compassionate mother, and she's got to wash her baby's face, and when she gets away, there's like something happens. It's kind of like, you see me, oh, yes, oh, it's beautiful today, and the sky, and oh, I smell the flowers. And you put a wet wash on, and they go, bring me a face. Man, my wife is a wonderful lady. She's a wonderful wife to me, a wonderful mother to our children. And she would take a wet washcloth. I thought she was trying to unscrew those boys' faces. I said, babe, let their face on. I don't know what happens to a mother. Just put a wet washcloth in their hand and something possesses them. Another thing, Rolf, mothers, I've only got two complaints. They don't appreciate stones. None of you girls appreciate stones. Of course, mothers always find them in the washing machine. That is not part of it, you know. But I mean, come on, guys, don't. But look, Mom, look at it. It's almost like a cube. Isn't that something? No. Well, look, Mom, it's the state of Ohio.
I don't care.
They just don't appreciate stones. God appreciates stones. Hey, you know, if somebody looks at a piece of stone, maybe you walk out and, you know, we'd preach in churches where they have stone parking lots. And man, I'm telling you, you take three boys to churches where they got stone parking lots, and pretty soon you got like 10,000 pounds of stones in your trailer somewhere. And, you know, but you walk past to find that one, you'll walk past a whole lot of stones, didn't even catch your attention, right? Isn't it amazing? God walked past a bunch of stones, and I'm looking at a whole church full of stones, and those stones have been put into the ephod over the heart of the high priest. Who is our high priest? Man, we are right next to the heart. We're not in his back pocket. We're not down around his ankle. I'm not something he's wearing on his wrist. I'm not a hat on his head. I'm right there. I can hear the thumping of that heart. I am like John sitting at the Last Supper, pillowing his head on the bosom of the universe. Could you imagine listening to the heartbeat of the universe? That's what he was doing. Guys, we walk right there, and then we get to step inside the Holy of Holies. Just get this. How many Jews could go into that Holy of Holies? One. So all them Jews got told no, and the dirt ball got in. Isn't that something? Guys, I'll tell you what. What mean you by these stones? I'll tell you what you mean. I'm just a dirty old stone. You say, well, what made you valuable? Nothing about me valuable. I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry. There's nothing about you that's valuable. Some of you can sing. I like that violin duet. That was so nice. And, you know, some of you can play piano and you can play some other instrument. We understand God doesn't need instrument players, and God doesn't need singers, and God doesn't need artists, and God doesn't need... He doesn't need a dentist. He doesn't need an eye doctor. He doesn't need whatever you do. There's nothing about us that heaven's going to be a better place when you step in. There's nothing about anybody in here. There's nothing about anybody in this state. There's nothing about anybody in this country. There's nothing about anyone on this planet, now or ever has been, that God looked down and saw that person and said, boy, heaven just won't be the same unless we can get that person right there. Jesus, go die for them. We need them. I'm telling you, the night when Jesus Christ was arrested, before he was crucified, when he was down on his knees, he said, let this cup pass from me. If his father would have said, yeah, son, come on home, let him go to hell, and we were all damned, I'm telling you, all humanity was damned, heaven would still be heaven and the angels would still be singing, because he is there. Ain't singing when you and I show up. They're not excited about us. They don't get as excited about a stone. Maybe they don't even see the value. The high priest does, doesn't he? What mean you by these stones? It means a dirt ball got converted into a gem. A very precious gem that got into the Holy of Holies. I want you to go back to Joshua chapter 4. Joshua chapter 4. And let's look at this. Begin to read about verse... let's pick it up. Let's start verse 1. I mean, you don't mind reading too much Bible. We're just going to read chapter 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. It came to pass, when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, take you 12 men out of the people, out of every man a tribe, and command ye them, saying, take you hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where your priest's feet stood firm. So here's what happened. those guys, those priests came in here, that water parted, and they stood here. They stood here, and the children of Israel, kind of like while they stood here, the water stayed. They didn't cross. They stood here. Then all Israel crossed. Then they got across, but the water's still staying. The Lord says, now wait, before I bring this water back, go back out there. And you see where the priests were standing? Yeah, okay, here's what I want you to do. And command them, verse 3, and command you them, saying, take you hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones, and you shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where you shall lodge this night. Then Joshua called the 12 men whom he had prepared of the children of Israel out of every tribe of man. And Joshua said unto them, pass over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of Jordan, and take you up every man of you a stone upon his shoulder according unto the number of the tribes of the children of Israel. For this shall be a sign among you, that when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean you by these stones? Then ye shall answer them that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord, when it passed over Jordan, and the waters of Jordan were cut off. And these stones shall be for a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. And the children of Israel did so as Joshua commanded, and took up 12 stones out of the midst of Jordan, as the Lord spake unto Joshua, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, and carried them over with them unto the place where they lodged, and laid them down there. Now, one of the things about stones in a river, they're round. In some way, that water always washing over. I don't mean they're perfectly round, but they're rounded, correct? You ever been out walking and you were walking on stone that was almost like it was just broken into pieces, and there were sharp edges? Man, you fall down, you cut yourself. You don't cut yourself on a river rock. So imagine they get into the promised land, and you got all this old rough, you know, craggy stuff. You ever been around lava? In Idaho, sometimes we take a 7-hour trip across the desert. We go past Craters of the Moon National Park. It is the single ugliest place I've ever seen on the planet. I mean, we saw it. It's ugly. It's just, if you got that lava rock in your grill, it is acres and acres of black lava rock. And there isn't anything about, you just want to go there. So if anybody says, you ever been there? Yeah, I've been there. Yeah, it's kind of like, okay, and I was at jail too, but I'm not going back to either one. So here you are. But now think about this. You got all this lava rock or sharp, big old pinnacles of rock. Don't you think those river rocks would stand out? So now let's just go fast forward. The high priests are dead. Everybody in Israel, they're dead. And those little children, 20 and under, now they got kids of their own. One day, when them little boys, you know, I don't even know if boys play outside anymore. Man, I don't know about you. You guys don't realize this. You are looking at the guy that when I was 9 years old, I sank every battleship and aircraft carrier that the Japanese Germans had left over from World War II. You say you did? Yeah, where were they? They were in a creek out back of my house. And all I needed was rocks. And I did that while I fought Indians, because back then you could. And I built a hydroelectric plant at the same time. And now you say, go play outside. The kid takes his PlayStation and sits on the patio. I'm playing outside. Why am I playing outside? This isn't air conditioned. You know? And so, but can you imagine this? Here's this Jewish dad. And his boy's been out roaming. Remember when you roamed? Well, I mean, we covered some ground, didn't we? And they've been roaming. And this boy says, hey, daddy, you know what we did today? What? Well, me and the guys, you know, we were down at the Jordan. We were skipping rocks and, you know, throw a stick out there and it'd be a Philistine canoe, and we were hitting it with rocks, whatever the case may be. And you know how those rocks are down at the river, Dad? Oh, yeah. Boy, you'll get cut on those real easy. You know what we found? We found this pillar of rocks. But, Daddy, those rocks were all rounded. They were all smooth. In fact, we looked in the river, and they looked like that's where they belong. How could that be? And that Jewish daddy went back and said, oh, yeah. Oh, son, let's go down there tomorrow. Next day, that little boy takes his dad. I'll bet Dad took him. He said, Daddy, I'll show you where it's at. You don't have to show me where it's at, son. You don't have to show me where it's at. I was here before. Last time I was here, I was your age. And he walked over there and he looked at those round river rocks because they stood out. You know what they meant by those stones? Those stones were put there expressly so a little Jewish child who was not around when it happened would say, "What mean you, Daddy, by these stones?" And that day said, "Son, where you look? Would you say? Do you think these rocks came from?" "Well, Daddy, they look like they came out of the river. But how would somebody get those out of the middle of the river?" "Son, what if I told you? Well, let me ask you this, son. If that river dried up, could they get the stones?" "Oh, yeah, Dad, that's Jordan. It's never dry, son. At least one time in history, I know it was dry." "Oh, Daddy, that's an old wives' tale. I've heard that." "Son, I crossed it when it was dry." "Yeah? I knew some of the men to pick these rocks up. I remember I was your age when they piled them up right here. And you know why we piled these rocks up here, son? For you. We wanted you to see these. We wanted you to question. We wanted you to wonder. We wanted you to ask about why these were here so we could tell you about the deliverance of our God." You know what we need, people? We need something to make our young people ask questions. No, I don't mean question, is there a God? Question, oh, is the Bible really the Word of God? Oh, do we really need all these stupid convictions? No. You know, you can do what you want with Christmas. We keep it. We keep Christmas for two reasons. One, we don't know the day the Lord was born. Might have been in September. I've heard people say April. I had one guy say he stated out, came up with December 25th. I don't know. I really don't know. But I know he was born. And since we don't know there was a day, one of the reasons we keep December 25th is because that's when everybody, the people don't keep Christmas. You don't have to keep Christmas. But people who don't, it's kind of like for 364 days, here's what we tell the lost world. Get your mind on God. One day a year they do it and we go, wrong day. I'm going to give them a break. But there's another reason why we keep Christmas. We get presents. Anyway. But you know, we've never had Santa Claus. I used to teach my boys, I said, only two people come down the chimney, the big bad wolf and Santa Claus, and they're both crooks. Never trust anybody enters your house through the chimney. Right? I mean, the guy's an honest man. He shouldn't be coming down the chimney. And I don't want the credit for what God did given to that guy. So we have Christmas, but we don't have Santa Claus, all right? But the thing is this, guys, you know, you take that time, can't you really explain a lot to your children? And if nothing else, what kid doesn't like Christmas? Because they're getting presents. They don't care about anything else. They're not worried about a historic date, who it was, or anything else. Isn't that right? But explain, we wouldn't even have this if it wasn't for God. And if you think these gifts are something, one of these days, there's a gift. Man, it'll last forever if you take it. We don't keep Easter. The reason we don't keep Easter is historically a pagan holiday. It was around long before the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And because we do know when the Lord came out of the grave. If you study your Bible, it was in Abib. We just translate that to April. It's not exactly April, but April. The Passover was on the 14th. The Passover was the 14th and the 15th to the 21st, the days of unleavened bread. And the Lord went in on the Passover. He died on the Passover. He went into the earth. He was into the grave for 3 nights and 3 days. So 14, 15, 16, the Lord came out of the grave on the 17th. So we keep Resurrection Day. And we do that for two reasons. One, because we appreciate God coming out of the grave. Any God that couldn't get out of the grave, let him there. You know, I don't understand these religions. I tell these people, I say, what good is a religion if it couldn't get the founder out of a hole in the ground? I don't know why a person be a Mormon when Mormonism couldn't get Joe Smith out. And I got news for you. I don't care who the Mormon is. None of them are as important as Joe Smith. And he's still a pile of dust. So if Mormonism couldn't get Joseph Smith out of a hole in the ground, what is it going to do for any other Mormon? And if Jehovah's Witnesses couldn't get Judge Rutherford out of the hole in the ground, and that's where he is, what good is Jehovah's Witnesses? And Muhammad is a hole. Look. Joseph Smith is a pile of dust. Judge Rutherford's a pile of dust. Mary Baker, Patterson, Glover, Eddy, Clinton, whatever. She's a pile of dust. Muhammad is a pile of dust. Buddha is a rather large pile of dust. But I don't want to really... Hey, guys, we were over there in October 2014. We're over in Israel and stepped into the tomb. Say, you really believe that's tomb? I really believe that's tomb. You don't have to come up and tell me why it's not. I couldn't care less. You're smarter than I am. I believe it's a tomb. But I don't care, guys. I don't care. Let me tell you what they did when they found that tomb. Now, you understand what Jews did. They buried somebody. They left them in a tomb for about a year, and then they moved them someplace else. So remember when it said a new grave that no man had laid in? That don't make any sense to you and me, because when you put a guy in a grave, we're done. But they, a grave could be used by 100 different people. They'd all be there for about a year, whatever, and they'd move them off. And so when they found the grave that is there in the garden, it is in a garden. The graveyard is 3 miles away. The tomb that you see is right around the corner from Calvary, and it's in a garden. And they said, no man ever laid there. Now, I don't care when the Lord came out of that grave. I don't care if they buried 14 goats in it. But when they found that grave, a forensic team went through there and dusted it all up and examined the dust. And they said, there is no DNA of any human ever decomposing in that grave. Now, my guess is that after he came out, somebody thought that place was special. Because I don't think you're going to find a Jew saying, well, let's just leave that one open. There was a reason to left that one open. Well, guys, that's our God. And he got out of the grave. And so I think you ought to have Christmas. I think you ought to keep Resurrection Day. I think you ought to explain baptism to them. I think you ought to explain what their salvation was, make it a second birthday, give them a gift. Barry Leakley back there. I've known him and his brother since they were little. And I remember that their dad would give them a gift on the day they got saved. He said it was their spiritual birthday. So I'm giving them a gift. And that way it was always special. Why am I getting it? Oh, it's because the day I got saved. Parents, you ought to do something. You know what you ought to do? You ought to do something to make your children wonder. Make them curious. You're not going to look a kid in the eye and go, you will believe this. Because they won't. They'll just shut up and follow you till they don't have to follow you anymore. Then they'll go out of church and never come back. But if you could, that boy's looking at those stones. And he's looking at that river. He says, it'd take a miracle. Nobody is going down into that river, holding their breath, picking that stone up, and walking out here with it. It would take a miracle. That's exactly what it'd take. Guys, isn't that what's so great about our God? He is miraculous. And so there were those stones. It was a memorial. So that the generations, what happened in Israel when a generation knew not Joseph? You know, we have got a generation in this country that knows not George Washington, knows not Abraham Lincoln, knows not Jesus Christ. I really believe this. I believe public school graduates, you know, I know they say the millennials are worthless. Well, that's because they are. They are. I don't blame them. I think they ought to be allowed to sue their public school teachers because they're the ones that taught them nothing. And there had to be a memorial, so they want to say, man, I want to know more about how these stones got here. It took a miracle. Yeah, it did. But now look at the next verse. There was another pile of stones. Verse 9. And Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priests which bear the Ark of the Covenant stood, and they are there unto this day. Okay, so here's what they did. Here's where the priests are standing in the middle of the river, right here in the middle of the river. So these guys go up and they get those sharp, not river rocks, and they walk down in the middle of the river, and they lay those down, and they pick up a smooth river rock, and they go out and build this pillar, and then they put the pillar in the river of the stones from the beach, which don't belong in the river, correct? So here's this Jewish dad, and he's showing this boy this column of stones, pillar of stones. Say, yes, son, I was your age. Man, I remember when they made this. I'm telling you, son, I'm telling you, God dried that Red Sea, that Jordan River. And come here, son. Walk up to the edge of the river. You ever try to look underwater? But you can. And he says, son, look out there. See about the middle of the river? Can you see that? Yeah, Dad. But you know what it looks like? Tell me.
Well, it looks like another pillar of rocks, but it looks like rocks from the shore.
Yeah. Hey, son, if that river didn't dry up, how'd those get there? You know what those were? Those were a pillar of testimony. Let me ask you something, guys. You ever hear anybody say there's no God? Or that Christianity is just another religion and it's no different than anybody else's? Hey, guys, if Jesus Christ did not die for our sins and raise the third day and save us, explain why you're here in church on Saturday night. Explain you. You know the greatest thing you have to talk to this world about is your testimony? You know, the Apostle Paul used his testimony two times. Both times he was in trouble. You want to have a good testimony because someday you may be in trouble. And the only thing you can go to is that testimony. And guys, if there's nothing to it, what am I doing here? And what are you doing here? What a bunch of nutcases. Yeah, your pastor. He told me one time, he said, used to have quart beer bottles rolling around the floor of his car. What is he doing in church on a Saturday night? Pastoring a church. You say, well, how do you explain that? Look out there in the middle of that river. I'd explain it. That's a memorial. You have any doubt? That proves it happened. You know what? If you have any doubt about Jesus Christ being real, I'm telling you, I prove it happened. You know what I was doing when I got saved? I was planning a robbery. Me and a buddy down at the bar, we're going to break into this guy's house. He's an antique dealer. We're going to break into his house when he wasn't home and steal some stuff. And I didn't think we'd get caught. Look, you got to really be stupid to get caught. Really, I mean, to get caught in the act, you got to be stupid. But don't worry, they'll knock on your door about 3 weeks later and haul you off to jail because the cops aren't stupid. You are. And so I didn't think we'd get caught that night, but I figured we probably would get caught and I'd end up in prison, but I didn't really care. I was 19 years old at that time, 20 years old, and I didn't care. And this guy says, well, what do we do if he comes home and catches us? And I said, we'll kill him. I didn't care. Before that robbery happened, I met Jesus Christ. Before that robbery happened, I crossed the Jordan River. And that guy is walking. Man, he's probably dead of old age now, but that guy stayed alive. So how do you know? That pillar. You know what somebody says to you, there's nothing to what you're doing and what you got. You know what you look back and say, how you explain I'm here? How do you explain I haven't killed you? How do you explain I haven't robbed you? How do you explain that I am not hurting people? How do you explain I'm sober and I'm off drugs and I'm moral? How do you explain that? Well, how do you explain it? Look down there in the river. You see that pillar? God had me put that pillar. Anytime I ever wondered, I was looking back in that pillar and go, oh yeah, I remember that. I remember that pillar. I remember how those rocks got there. I know how I got here tonight, guys. I got here from an altar. I got here from the middle of the Jordan River. I am here because I crossed the Jordan. Do you understand? And I can still remember the pillar. There's another. One last, I want you to look at 1 Kings chapter 18. What mean ye by these stones? First Kings chapter 18 is the famous chapter where Elijah takes on the prophets of Baal, and he wins, and he kills them. I guess he was a distant relative of General Mattis, who said, some folks, it's just fun to kill them. He said, some people need killing. I guess Elijah said, yeah, we got about 450 that need killing, and he did it. But it says this, look at verse 30. And Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all the people come near unto him. Now remember this. This is the nation that crossed the Jordan River. But they ain't been down by that river for years. They forgot about the pillar in the river. They forgot about the pillar out of the river. They forgot about the pillar at the foot of the Jordan, at the foot of Mount Sinai. They're far from God. Is this nation not far from God, people? You know, the last king of Israel that brought it down so far was Manasseh. And you know how Israel was described when a Manasseh was done with it? They were worse than the heathen. Next year I'll be preaching in New Guinea. And I mean, it's a heathen nation, guys. I'm telling you the truth. there are people over there ain't got the sense to not sit in a puddle of water. They'll sit in a puddle of water. Ain't got any sense at all. They're heathen. And if I go to the lost people in New Guinea and I say, hey, you know what? You think the United States is nice, don't you? Oh, yeah, wonderful country. We let men marry men. You know what those lost people in New Guinea say to me? Man, we don't allow that here. We're worse than the heathen. I mean, we have come far from God, and this nation has come far from God, and here was this man of God, and he said this. He said, come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. Is that not symbolic of the entire problem with that country? That was the whole problem. The altar had been broken down. And you know, some of you remember when you used to get together with your family and you read your Bible, or at least you got alone and you read your Bible, you got alone, you get down on your knees, you actually confessed your sins to God and got them cleared up until somebody told you don't have to confess them anymore. Boy, you never should have listened to that. It says this in verse 31, and Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order and cut the bullock in pieces and laid him on the wood and said, fill 4 barrels with water. Let me ask you a question. What's going on in Israel at this time? What? Okay, in a drought. What's the most precious thing you got? That didn't take much to figure out, did it? Fill 4 barrels with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. Now think about it. First off, he knows he's dealing with Jews. Meaning, when they go, you got any water? Oh, no, I don't have any water. You got any water? Oh, no, we don't have any water. Yeah, they do. Yes, they do. I sure as you bunch of Baptists say you got no money. You got money somewhere put away. I don't have any bullets. Yes, you do. You ain't telling anybody, but you got something put away. You got food put away. And so he stands there, he goes, you Jews, you want rain? Yeah, okay. I want 4 barrels of water. Now you see the crowd going, Irving. What did he say? Did he say 4 barrels of water? Yeah, he said 4 barrels of water. Well, we ain't got 4 barrels of water. Oh, come on, you know you got some water. I saw your water. Well, okay, I'll tell you what, I got 9 gallons. I'll bring 3. And we'll put those in the barrels, and that's my part. And I still got 6. And so we pour 3 gallons of water. Look at this. I'm bringing, all the water I got. And they poured on the wood. Look at verse 34. And he said, do it the second time. Tell me he didn't say that. Oh, yeah, he said that. Did he say, do it again? Do it again. But I don't have any more. Yeah, you got 6 barrels. You got 6 gallons. Oh, yeah. And he wants 3 more, doesn't he? Yeah, okay, I still got 3. Okay, look, I pound some more. I forgot I had this. And they did it the second time. And he said, do it the third time. Oy, he didn't say that. Yeah, he said that. Let's kill him. I'd rather kill him than lose the water. Give him the water. You already left 6 gallons. May as well get rid of the last 3. But then I got no more. I know. You want to see God work? Yeah, I'd like to see it rain. Well, give him the water. I don't know how that works. I don't either. Let's just give it to him and trust God. And the water ran about the altar and filled the trench also with water. Now, come on. I got a feeling a bunch of them Jews weren't looking at the wood and they weren't looking at the altar. I really believe this. I'll guarantee there's a few of them saying, if it does not rain, I am going to kill him. They're looking at that water in that little moat and thinking, that's my family's life. And this guy just poured it on the ground. And now I don't have anything else. And if God doesn't take care of us, we're goners. It came to pass the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things in thy word, at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast that thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood, which was saturated with water, and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, "The Lord, He is God, the God, the Lord, He is the God." And then I don't have to keep on reading, but look what it says, verse 41. Elijah said unto Ahab, "Get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain." And it rained after 3.5 year drought. And it rained after 3.5 year drought after they got rid of every hope they had of their own. But you know how it all started? They used those stones to prepare that altar. Now think about that. You know, we were in Montana, up in the mountains, with the pastor and his wife. You know, we're walking up through the mountains, and there's a meadow there. And you're in the middle of nowhere. And there was an old, broken down log house. I mean, it wasn't no more than one room. And it was like, at the edge of the roof, it was only about this tall. So it was not a tall place. And it had been built many, many years, easily back in the 1800s, and it had finally rotted down and fallen in. And you ever do that? You ever drive down the road and you see an old house? And do you ever think, oh man, the stories. Don't you know every old house that you see was a new house at one time? Think about this. Every old house that you see, this old decrepit house out in the middle of the prairie somewhere, out in the middle of a field that is all disheveled and it's caving in, it's falling down, there was a day that somebody walked through the door the first time and it was the answer to their dream, wasn't it? Don't you know that somebody lived in that house, and when they saw that old broken down house, they thought about what had gone on when they were there before. I talked to a pastor friend of mine. He and his wife were students of mine 30-some years ago up at Maslin, And I preached for him up in Maine. And he was up in this little fishing village. Oh, what a fishing village. Up in Maine. And it's not the edge of the world, but you can see where the water goes over from there. He took this church. It was already over 150 years old. It was on the National Register of Historic Buildings. When he took this church, his youngest member was 65 years old. I am telling you, people, I get up to preach, and here's how they were when they were mad. And here's how they were when they were glad. I could have gone out there and taken their pulse. I got several wristwatches, in fact. You know, just took them off. They look like mannequins. And it was a Sunday through Friday, and Friday night, we're sitting around I'm telling you, I could have preached to an empty barn full of, animals could have done more, you know. And these people just sat there and sat there and sat there. And Friday night, he said, "We had a good meeting." I said, "How can you tell?" And he said, "Mrs. So-and-so, some 9,000-year-old lady or whatever she was," he said, "tonight she laughed out loud." That was a sign of revival in these Mainers. And of course, they beat her to death with a codfish. And I told Kathy this, though, you know, during this, about halfway through this meeting, I figured this out. I said, "You know what I think? I think I'm shock therapy." I think he said, before he asked me to come and preach this, I think he said, "I'll have Sam Gipp in, and if that don't get this thing going, I'm out of here." I said, "Let's watch. I'll bet he's gone in 6 months." He was gone in 3. I said, "You ever go up there?" He said, "You know, we were up there a little while back." I said, "How is it?" He said, "Oh, it's all roped off. Roof's caved in. Porch has fallen in. Can't go up the steps. They're rotted down. Foundation is caving in." You know what he remembers? He remembers having service there. He remembers standing behind the pulpit of that church and pastoring those people. He remembers having me or other speakers. And he does remember when the Spirit of God was in that building. And now it's just an old empty building and people drive by it all the time. Doesn't mean a thing to him. And you know what this altar was? Oh, a lot of people walk by and just say it was an old pile of rocks. But I bet some of them Jews go, "I used to go to church here. I remember my dad ran around that thing shouting one night." Boy, he never was the same after that. But we haven't talked to God for a long time. God hasn't visited us for a long time. You know what was wrong with Israel? They thought they needed water the most. That wasn't what they needed at all. They need to get back connected to the God of the water. And they repaired that altar. You know what they did? They repented of where they were wrong. They repaired that altar. They rededicated themselves and returned to living for God. You know what I think some of you remember? I told you, I'm telling you, some of you remember when you were on fire for God. Some of you remember when Sunday was a special day because you got to go to church and you were excited about it. Now it's, oh man, we got to get up tomorrow. Oh yeah, and he's been preached too long anyway, and I'll probably miss part of the football game, and I just can't believe it. Why do I have to go? You know what you need to do? You need to repair that altar. What mean you by these stones? What's he doing? What's this stupid guy? He's going to take it. These 450 guys are going to kill him. And he's picking up rocks. That's okay, boys. Just let me do what I got to do. We'll see how this turns out. Guys, what I'm telling you is he repaired that altar and Israel got right with God. And I'll bet you some of you can look back at a time in your life, say what you want about you don't have to spend as much time in church now and it doesn't cost you as much because you don't bother giving money to missions anymore and you don't read your Bible so you have more TV time. God forbid we don't have enough TV time. You aren't as happy as you used to be. No life is happy that does not hear the voice of God. You know what you need to do? You know exactly what you, and you knew before you ever came in this door. You need to repair that altar. What mean you by these stones? We fixed our altar up. I'll bet you some of them people, you know, I told my wife something today. I never thought I'd say it. Trump did another great thing today, and I can't even remember what it was. And I told, because come on, guys, isn't our last marker Ronald Reagan? Nobody longs for the days of George W. Bush. Nobody longs for the days of George H.W. Bush, except maybe the Democrats. The last guy that loved this country as president of the United States was Ronald Reagan. And we remember those days, don't we? And I said, babe, Trump may end up better than Reagan. I never thought I'd say that. Maybe he won't, but I'm telling you what, he's been doing some stuff, hadn't he? And some of them people looked at old altar and said, I remember. Man, I remember. We'll never have those days again. Boy, I'll bet you when that rain started shouting, I'll bet some people were jumping high, stepping around that altar. I'll bet they were shouting and saying, man, we never had it this good in my dad's day. I remember when I was a little kid and we danced around this, that we had this altar. Man, we never had a service like we had today. We thank God today. We got in touch with God today because Israel got back to God. Maybe that's what you need to do. They just piled up some stones, didn't they? What mean you by these stones? Well, we mean this is where I met God and heard from God my first time, and this is where I chose I will serve this God. What mean you by these stones? An old piece of dirt got right next to the heart of the high priest and got to go into the Holy of Holies. Man, we have no business going to that Holy of Holies, but we're going there because we're hanging around the right place. What mean by these stones up on? I just want our children need to ask questions. Why do we do this, Dad? Why do we have Sunday school and Sunday morning? And why do we have an evening service? And why do we do it this way? And why does everything have to be out of the Bible, out of the Bible, out of the Bible? Well, son, let me explain. What mean you by those stones? Hey, if you don't think that river ever stopped, how'd them stones get there? And if you don't think there's anything to Jesus Christ saving some sinner, how do you explain you being here? How do you explain somebody here? You couldn't be trusted after dark. Some of you were thieves and liars. And man, I'm telling you, I mean, they're just not a good crowd here. You know how I know? Because you're human. You are as bad as me. I have a hard time thinking some of you people are bad. Now look at Rob. I don't have any problem thinking he's bad. The rest of you, maybe you could be good. But you know how I know you're bad? Because all men are created equal. And I know I am wicked, desperately wicked, and you're like me. The worst thing I can say about you people is you're like me. But that makes you pretty bad. What are you doing in church on a Saturday night? Tell that crazy world out there, ain't nothing your religion. Or you, they, man, what am I doing in church on Saturday night? There's something to it. Look in that river, see that pile of stones. Maybe tonight you need to go to that pile of stones that used to be an altar. Maybe you remember a place used to be so holy, you and God would just have some time there and you'd get down on your face and you'd talk to him and you'd read your Bible. And what happened, guys? We get too busy? Did we get too organized? Now our phone is doing it for us. Yeah, I just typed the prayer in, my prayer, and then it just every day at the same time it just cycles through and it prays it so I can be watching TV while it does it. Man, it's just saving. I'm just really. It's just quality time. I'm multifunctioning. That's what I'm doing. No. You just need to get down on your face. You need to rebuild that altar. Get down on your face and get back to God. I'd like you to stand with your heads bowed. What mean ye by these stones in the desert? Do you remember the first time you met God? Do you remember the first time you heard from God? What is a God who has so much power he could speak a universe into existence? What is he doing? Taking the time to communicate to an individual like you and me. You remember when you heard from him? You remember when you chose him? Do you ever think about what you are, just a walking, talking piece of dirt? Wouldn't turn anybody's head. And yet now you hang around the neck of the high priest, next to his beating heart, and enter the Holy of Holies with him. Maybe you parents need to make your Christianity something that your children want to say, why we do that? I want to do that. I like why we do that, Dad. I'm glad I understand it now. Maybe some of you need to just go stand by the Jordan River and peer in that water and look at that pillar down there. Some of you have forgotten how good it was to get saved. Some of you have forgotten what it was like to see that Jordan River in front of you and think, we can't get across that. And then you walked across it on dry ground. If there's nothing to Christianity, what are we doing here tonight on a Saturday night in church? Maybe somebody needs to repair that altar. Like Israel repaired theirs in 1 Kings 18, just reconnect with God. Shut the phone off and power down the tablet. Turn off the computer. You don't need to interface with anybody but the Creator of the universe. Maybe you need nothing more technologically advanced than a stone. Father, God, what a holy thing that we could come to church on Saturday night. Probably, God, some of these people here, being here tonight, on a Saturday of this night, more than any other, it probably means more to you than the other night of the week. Some of these folks, they go to their churches, or they come to this church on a Sunday night because there's Sunday night service. But that they would show up on a Saturday night, I sometimes wonder if that just doesn't turn your head. I wonder if you don't just give some angel an elbow in the ribs and say, that guy used to tell jokes about my cross. Now he's in church singing about me. Lord God, thank you. And I hope someone heard from you, and I hope they respond to you, and I hope they understand what we mean by these stones. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. With your heads bowed and eyes closed, as the piano plays, folks are on their faces to God. If you need to come, why don't you come? If you need to repair that altar, repair it. If you need to revisit those pillars in the desert, that first time you heard from God, that place you were when you met him, what you said when you said, I will live for you the rest of my life. I will live for you long as I breathe, long as I can see, as long as I can speak, long as I've got strength. I choose you as my God. That's what Israel did. If you need to come, you come.